In mathematics, we often solve for x, but what about y? If math is about numbers, then what is the letter e doing here? E, also known as Euler's number, represents the irrational number 2.71828182845 and so on, continuing forever, and is a very important number in mathematics. You may recognize this number when working with natural logarithms, exponential functions, continuous compound interest, just to name a few. It's similar to how we use the symbol pi to represent the irrational number 3.141596 and so on, which comes from dividing a circle circumference by its diameter. But where does e come from? Let's look at the quantity 1 plus 1 over n to the nth power. And if you're wondering where this comes from, think about interest and see if you can think about how this is related to that. As n goes to infinity, or in other words, as we plug in bigger and bigger numbers into this formula, the values will approach e. Or if we look at the graph, we can see that the curve gets closer and closer to e. Another way we can calculate e is with a crazy equation using factorials. I'll start it, and I think you'll be able to see the pattern from there. We have 1 over 0 factorial, plus 1 over 1 factorial, plus 1 over 2 factorial, plus 1 over 3 factorial, and so on and so forth. As you add more and more terms to this equation, the sum approaches e. And this is actually how Euler originally calculated e. The function e to the x has a lot of really neat properties. For example, those of you that have taken calculus, you'll know that the derivative of e to the x is e to the x. Or in simpler terms, the slope at any point along this curve is equal to the y value at that point. And this is the only type of function whose derivative is itself. That's a pretty neat property. And similarly, thinking about integration, we can see that the area under the curve is also equal to e to the x. So at any point on this curve, the y value, the slope, and the area under the curve all have the same value. And only functions in the e to the x family will have this property. Another interesting idea that I came across on the website mathsisfun.com is called the cut up then multiply method. So what this means is we take a number, we cut it up into equal parts, and multiply those parts together. And the goal is to figure out how many pieces to cut it into so that when you multiply them all together, the result is as big as possible. So for example, let's take the number 8. We can cut 8 into 2 equal parts of size 4, then multiply those two parts together and get 4 times 4 equals 16. Now if we cut 8 into 3 equal parts, they'll be of size 8 thirds. And then if we multiply 8 thirds by itself 3 times, or in other words, take 8 thirds cubed, we'll end up with approximately 18.96. And now if we cut 8 into 4 equal parts of size 2 and multiply those together, we get 2 to the 4th, or in other words, 16. So first we had parts of size 4, then 8 thirds, or in other words, 2.6 repeating, and then 2. And as it turns out, whichever part is closest in size to e, that will give the biggest result when you multiply them. Now remember, e is approximately 2.7, so in this case, 8 thirds is the closest to e, being 2.6 repeating, which means that this should give us the biggest result, and it did. I just thought that was really interesting and wanted to share it with you since I had never really heard of that before. And now I will leave you with what is often called the most beautiful equation in mathematics, and that is e to the I times pi power plus 1 equals 0. This was only a brief introduction to Euler's number, so I just wanted to highlight a few key concepts here. This video was actually suggested by one of my subscribers, so if you have a suggestion for what you'd like to see next, please leave a comment down below, and I'll see you next time. This was What About Why?